Evening presentation by Brother David Paul Lang. Let me give you a brief introduction for Brother David Paul. He has known this campus since he was a little boy because his dad, Jack, taught in the math department of SJU for
40
years, an even number. David Paul is one of those guys who's multi-talented, having graduated from St. Olaf College with a degree in philosophy, but having started out studying mathematics. At St. Olaf as well, he was able to continue the development of his stellar singing voice, given their really outstanding music program. Brother David Paul came to this community as a novice in 1986 and worked in campus ministry as a faculty resident, up at the Red Lake Indian Mission for a while, and in a variety of ways gave attention to justice and peace issues. He then began taking the prerequisite courses in art to pursue study and work in three-dimensional art. He earned his MFA at Southern Illinois University at Edwardsville and came into our art department here, CSB and SJU, in 2001. Brother David Paul also spent years on the campus design committee, working with and listening to some very skilled architects who serve on that committee, always attempting to be respectful of the Breuer legacy, both in the Abbey University Church as well as the other Breuer buildings on campus. In addition, he has prayed in that church since 1986. At present, he also, in addition to teaching, he serves as sub-prior for the monastery. So the title of Brother David Paul's presentation this evening is Praying in a Modernist Space: Thoughts on Marcel Breuer's Design for the Abbey and University Church. Please give Brother David Paul a warm Collegeville welcome.
Thank you. Give me a chance to close this out. What you've been watching is archival footage of the day of dedication of the Abbey Church. Victoria Young, a faculty member at St. Thomas, whose book, by the way, on the building of the Abbey Church, and particularly Marcel Breuer, will come out this fall, her team actually converted the original film that practically no one had watched into digital formats. So we're watching this really for one of the first few times that it's ever been aired. So if I'm sure we'll see more of it now that it's she's given it to St. John's. So it's in our collection if anybody's interested. Okay. A real quick plug for two things. If you've not made it over to the Art Center, Brother Simon Wah's video installation, Contuitus, A View from the Monastery, is there, and it's definitely worth taking a look at. And you kind of need to give it at least a half an hour or more of your time in order to see the films through their completion. And then Joe O'Connell's retrospective show just opened on Friday over at St. Ben's. So if you haven't seen that, which is not likely just yet, do go take a look. There are sculptures that I've not seen before until now. Stunning examples of this man's work through his lifetime. So tonight, I thought I'd do two things. I'd share a little bit about my own personal experience of praying in the church, but only a little, because praying is such a subjective thing, even as it's both an individual and communal activity. So I'll share a little bit about that and how I think I've been shaped by this space since being, well, since a child. So I would say I've actually been praying in this church long before 1986. My parents would bring us out here for Christmas and Easter and a few Sundays in between. And we would often sit in the balcony, which I loved. The view up there and that sense of space for a child was amazing. I just loved the whole scale of it. And nobody really spoke to me about the design of that church until 20 years later. So I think I formed my own opinion of it for several decades without really knowing a whole lot about art history. So I'll share a little bit of my personal experience, and then I'll walk you through some of the context out of which that church emerged. For my students, I think that's one of the most helpful things is to know something about the context in which this church was built, the age in which it was designed, the things the community was interested in, so that we can form our own opinions about it, but perhaps from a more informed point of view. At the same time, this is a very diverse crowd. Some of you have actually lived through the entire building and design of that Abbey Church. You knew what it was like to pray in the former Abbey Church, now Great Hall, and now in the Abbey Church. So we have people who've been here much longer than I, and we have perhaps some students who only arrived last fall. So we're a whole cross-section and a wide spectrum of experience in this room. I hope I don't assume too much, but I hope you also find it interesting if you've been living here for 50 years. The church is definitely at its peak when it's full of people. If I can make any observation that leads to my own personal experience of praying in the church, it is that there are no figurative representations of anyone in the main body of the church except for the small corpus on the cross that spins, if you've ever noticed it, turning outward on a Sunday and then turning right back again, and occasionally an icon that we place in the ambo, in the front of the ambo. Otherwise, the people assembled are the icons of God. They are the figurative art, if you will, in that space. And that's a powerful thing in and of itself. When I go in there, I'm struck, I'm a visual person. And I would say, I'll be honest, I love that space. I love practically everything about it. I would like to change some things if they were up to me, but I still love it. And among the things that I love about that space for praying is the flood of natural light, the view to the outside, if even only to the cloister walks that are bound by the clay tile on the other side, or the little sliver of clear glass that allows you to see every now and then someone walking by on the sidewalk on the northeast and northwest corners of the church. But the flood of natural light, you know if it's raining or not while you're praying. You can tell if it's snowing. The lightning, when it doesn't throw out the power, sheds all sorts of light into the space. Before we put screens on those giant windows that are at floor level, squirrels used to join us, birds used to join us, bats used to join us. The nature itself was part of our prayer in an even more direct way, but it's still there. And you can't help but be aware of the time of day. We're not praying in a basement. I'd be one of those people you'd have to take kicking and screaming to go pray always and forever in the basement away from the light of day and the acoustic in that space. You don't have to be a trained musician to close your eyes and be aware that the space in that room is profoundly different than this space, the more absorbent acoustic that we have in here, is not like what you get in the Abbey Church. It's a challenge for speaking in there. We only solved the sound problem relatively recently with how many hundreds of speakers under the seats. But we've solved it for the most part. Now you can at least hear what people are saying. But it was definitely designed for singing. You can hear singing in that space, often without any amplification whatsoever, with a single person singing. It is beautiful for sound. It's beautiful for light. And there's so little that attracts your attention other than the altar, especially at night when the lighting focuses. The light, it's the brightest spot in the room, that top of the altar that we can see. It focuses one's attention, I guess my own attention, in a way that being in a much busier space in a space with lots of artwork, and I'm speaking as an artist, would not do. The simplicity of it is amazing to me personally. And it's not by accident on the part of Marcel Breuer or the building committee. Let me lead you into a little bit of then a discussion of that. And before I do, I need to make one more plug. And Father Hilary, are you here? Can you show me your... Father Hilary is our sole surviving member of the committee that worked with Marcel Breuer to design the Abbey Church. If you've not yet read a copy of his book, Marcel Breuer and a Committee of 12 Plan a Church, this is a good read. And I highly encourage reading it while you can still ask him questions afterwards, because he didn't have time to cover everything. And I personally have a number of questions I still have to send your way at some point, because the conversation between Marcel Breuer and the committee and the builders and contractors is rich. Victoria Young, the author, the art historian, has uncovered, in fact, she was sent two boxes from David Klingemann of correspondence that he didn't really know were there relatively recently, within a number of months ago. And he said, you might be interested in this. And lo and behold, they're letters between Marcel Breuer and the contractor. And they heat up as you get into the building process and you come towards completion, especially when you come to the main window itself on the north side. So there's some rich stuff in there. There's still things to be understood, to investigate, to seek to understand about this design. To fully appreciate it, especially when I'm teaching this topic with my sculpture students and art history students, we have to start back at the beginning, in a sense, the building of the first church, and here's a photo of it in 1874, from Prep School Point, the laundry building, over where the science hall is now, looking back. And one of my favorite shots, Stella Maris Chapel. Trees had a ways to go, so you know, lest we think we can't build any or plant anymore. It was rather barren when the quad was completed. By the way, you can also see the newer brick where they had to reassemble the floor that was torn off by the tornado. What's interesting, though, particularly for our purposes, are where the monks came from. I had the fortune of going along with this wonderful trip of people that we've been able to send for several summers now, the Benedictine Heritage Tour, faculty, staff, administrators, just this wonderful cross-section of all the people that have worked here and continue to work here. We get to visit sites in Italy and sites in Germany, especially in Germany, where the brothers and sisters came from who founded St. Benedict's Monastery and St. John's Abbey. They are not far apart, even in southern Germany. If this is Munich, that's about an hour's, it depends on how fast you drive on the Autobahn, about an hour's drive up to Metten and then over to Eichstätt. But when you walk in their church, or at least when I did, I was struck by several things immediately. One thing in particular, I kicked myself for not photographing. Their windows on all the sides are, guess, honeycombs. Only, they're only this big. You see them all around Europe in lots of places, monasteries included, but that honeycomb design is everywhere. It just doesn't happen to be 5 feet wide and thick concrete the way Americans, and particularly Marcel Breuer at this point, would have designed for St. John's. But the fullness of the design, the artwork, the sheer amount to look at is striking. Here was our own church in 1888. You know, it's still basically plain walls and a wooden altar at the back. Here it is by 1900. People have been busy. really busy by 1911. Notice they've now added an architectural canopy, a baldachin, over the altar. And by 1933, Clement Frischauf had gone over to the Abbey of Beuron to learn this style called Beuronese art so that he could paint that beautiful apse of Christ the Good Shepherd and the angels covering their faces around the altar. Splendid, as well as the murals in the refectory, the monastery refectory, and other smaller lunettes and other works around the university. But you can see that it's gotten filled up. Ours is not in the same style as the Abbey of Metten, but from a similar sort of German love for artwork and lots of it and the best materials you can possibly afford, there's a similarity here. They've definitely tried to do the best they could with filling the space with the best artwork, the best materials, and so on and so forth. Fast forward, it's 1953. Things have changed. I often have to ask my students, well, so what happened in the 40s? And, you know, for a while there's crickets, and they have to remember, okay, there's a Second World War that ended, and the GI Bill that made our population just mushroom overnight, both in the monastery and especially in the college. At 1953, everything's still out of red brick. Notice that. There's a certain amount of uniformity of construction at this time, but things are very crowded, as my dad can attest, right? John, it's a, yeah, and by the way, I tell my students, Mary Hall was senior housing. That was desired housing in 1953. That was the place to live, Mary Hall. On March 7th, in 1953, Abbot Baldwin Dvorak writes a letter to 12 architects. By the way, they include these people. And he says, I'm writing to ask whether you'd be interested in preparing a comprehensive building plan and report for St. John's Abbey. We must build in the near future, he says. And we believe that we should not begin any construction until a plan has been prepared that will provide for our long-range needs, so that all of our buildings will form a complete and unified whole. Oops, I must have jumped forward. Oh, forgive me, I forgot. I wanted to show you what some of these people did. So we have Gropius and Belluschi and Saarinen and Neutra. Here's some examples of what they designed. Gropius designed the famous Bauhaus school itself. Belluschi, the Juilliard School in New York. So even now, you might be thinking, oh, too bad Belluschi didn't do it, or Saarinen. Imagine if Saarinen had done it. He did the JFK original terminal, some of you might know, a beautiful elliptical roof line at the main terminal there. Richard Neutra, who done mostly houses, and beautiful houses at that. Here's one out in California. Interiors where, you know, walls could disappear, or there'd be floor-to-ceiling glass, where things were treated as planes of different materials and different textures, simplified, and yet there's nothing boring about this. The outside, the landscape, plays a key role in modernist design. What you see through all that glass matters. Joseph Murphy, St. Anne of Normandy Church, kind of glad he didn't do the church. And then Marcel Breuer, who until this time had really been known for his houses. Hungarian-born, of Jewish descent. I'll tell you a little bit more about his history, especially in Germany, but mostly houses. He had, however, just finished a collaboration with other architects in Paris, the UNESCO headquarters, those are the cultural headquarters of the United Nations. And note this. So this just finished in 1953, the year of this letter. This is the inside. It's the back wall of the stage, the folded concrete, the poured folded concrete. Even walking through the passageways out in the lobby and beyond, isn't this interesting? Do you even see a little a vocabulary developing with his use of concrete and simple solid forms used in innovative ways. And of course, he does the Whitney Museum of Art in 1966, which is still one of the most, well, it's an amazing building. If you've ever been in there, you've probably had a sense of deja vu. Here's a stairwell in the Whitney Museum, and everything from the way these work, though they're squared, not quite as rounded as ours in the monastery are, but the use of material, this beautiful texture, the stone, the concrete, the wood, the metal, they occur here in a vocabulary that's very similar to that of the science hall, the library, the monastery, Pat Bernie Bonney, the Abbey Church. Even the coffered ceilings in the galleries are interesting. Yeah. So back to the letter. We think we need a comprehensive building plan. We think we shouldn't design anything until we can make sure that we end up with a harmonious plan where all of our buildings are going to form a complete and unified whole. Of course, that's not what happens. We have a very eclectic campus at the end of the day. We take great care to try to make sure the buildings are well made and interesting and designed well, but they don't form that complete and unified whole that Abbot Baldwin had set out to try to achieve. Nonetheless, that is a goal, and it's the second sentence in the letter. We don't want, he also says, the mere material exigencies of the situation to determine our architecture. Just because we need a church that'll seat 2,000 people does not mean we want to throw up a barn or one big airplane hangar that looks like crap. It should look amazing, even as it's serving the function. The community's needs, he says, well, if we were a new community, this would be easy. If we were starting out with a blank slate, easy peasy, but it's not. He says, we're gonna need a new monastic quarters, library, guest house, which eventually comes along 40 years later, an administration building, and then a much larger church. And he says, we think the church has to take precedence. We really need that, though the monastery wing ultimately is built first. And then he starts to say some of the most amazing things. They all come in the last paragraph of his letter. He says, although this present proposal concerns the comprehensive plan, we're most interested in this church that will be truly an architectural monument in the service of God. Sheer overcrowding forces us to expand these facilities. And the Benedictine tradition at its best challenges us to think boldly and to cast our ideals in forms which would be valid for centuries to come, shaping them with all the genius of present-day materials and techniques. That sentence in and of itself is extraordinary. Think boldly? Ideals in forms? I mean, that in itself, how you do that is already hard enough, but forms which are going to be somehow hopefully valid for 100 or more years, shaping them with all the genius of present-day materials and techniques. No offense to any other religious order that might be a little less accommodating or interested, perhaps, in what new technologies there might be, and therefore let's use as little as possible. Benedictines have always seemed to embrace new technologies. If there's a new way to farm that will help our crop yield, goodness, let's use it. If there's a new way to do something that will be more efficient, perhaps we could come up with a beverage, like some beer or champagne or something, or something that, you know, can make use of these grains in an interesting way, or whatever it might be, let's use them. And that it's also extraordinary at this time that a monastery is asking architects to use their best building techniques, the newest techniques, and not just give us an old style in this design. And finally, though not finally, but the second to last sentence, and I think it's one of the most interesting of all, he says, we feel that the modern architect with an orientation toward two things. Functionalism and an honest use of materials is uniquely qualified to produce a Catholic work. That's extraordinary. He doesn't say, we think you need to be Catholic to design this very Catholic space. He doesn't say you have to also be a monk in order to design a monastery and a monastery, abbey, university, church. He says you need to have this orientation toward functionalism and an honest use of materials. I think that's extraordinary. From a design standpoint, I get the functionalism, but it's the honest use of materials that I am continually inspired by. Let me give you a little context here. If a modern architect, well, modernism, it has two sort of monikers. Form follows function in modernism, and sometimes we say function dictates the form. Effectively, the form and the function should go hand in glove. One should not be more important than the other. The function should not trump all aesthetic choices and decisions, but the aesthetic should not trump the function either. There shouldn't be all this attention to the visual, let's say, frosting in the church and not thought given to its actual function. This tenuous marriage between the two is what sets modernism apart from so many other movements in architecture before this. Some examples. This is considered one of the first truly modern houses, and notice the date. Villa Savoy by Corbusier outside of Paris. We're talking early in the 20th century. It uses all sorts of innovative things from built-in furniture and furniture designed by the architect to a wonderful garage that's built under the house, and the whole curving radius here is perfect for, apparently, for a 1928 Citroën, so you can turn around under your house and park in it, actually under it. It had these very simple pillars, no capitals or bases, very, very simple. And a little bit unorthodox method for getting from one floor to the next. A bit of a half spiral, but two ramps in the house for getting from one floor to the next. If you don't already see a little bit of something going on in Breuer's mind with the ramp going up that wonderful balcony, guess again. On top of the house, we had some very strange things happening for other people at the time, other architects. First, it's all painted white, and you have no roof on it, but you have windows that frame your landscape just like a painting. Modular windows, that white. The architect said, no more of that, thank you. All the stuff that architects had taken great delight in doing, all that, think of this as a wedding cake, all the frosting, all the fun stuff. A modernist architect says, you don't really need that, though. It doesn't really need to be there for the building to function. Can our buildings pay attention to the function more than people had in the past and let go of the things that were not functional? By the way, notice it also sits on flat grass, flat lawn. Here's Mies van der Rohe's Farnsworth house, actually up on stilts. Here's the entrance to it. Wall-to-wall glass, floor-to-ceiling glass, a roof that's basically a floating plane parallel to the floor. Mies van der Rohe's Seagram building in New York, extraordinary for the time. This is sitting on some of the most expensive real estate in all of New York City, on the planet for that matter. And what does it do with the front half of the block? He doesn't build on it. He lets it be this, in our parlance, negative space as opposed to the positive space of the building. For van der Rohe, this free space was as important to the experience of going into the building and the building itself as the block, just filling it out with a whole building. That free space sort of foreshadowing the canyon this would one day become, where now the buildings all around it are just as tall, and when you walk on the streets of Manhattan, you feel you're in shadow most of the day, except at high noon. This free space is extraordinary. None of that stuff. Steel and glass, simplified form. Even the Chrysler Building, which is almost built around the same time, that wonderful top, the reticulating top, too much ornamentation. At night, by the way, it sits on a bed of light, denying the weight of the whole structure, which is another interesting thing you'll see continually in modern architecture. The use of light, the play of light, both during the day and then with artificial light at night. Philip Johnson actually built a glass house in which you should not throw those stones. And then he lived in it. It was a little stuffy, they said, in the summer, not great ventilation, but an extraordinary building on its site. And then Richard Neuter. And I throw this image in just to show you this would have been an extraordinary thing at the time. This new technology for combining plates of glass in a corner and effectively taking out the cornerstone. There's no longer the solid corner that for centuries would have kept the two walls perpendicular to each other, in right relationship to one another. There's a reason the cornerstone is laid first, and off of that all measurements are based. But in this new architecture, all of a sudden, the rules are being broken right and left. At least visually, they're being broken. And you can build with all sorts of minimal materials that can carry great weight without a lot of mass. And it seems to show you the things out of which it's actually made. So functionalism, that a building function, I think we can get our minds around that. What does it need to do, especially with the church? Okay, how many times do you come in to pray? How do you want to sit in relationship to each other? What do you do in the sanctuary? What do you have to be able to do around the altar? How does communion work? Once you figure out all those things, the next set of questions have to do with, so what will make this an honest space? I'm always asking my students, with this two images together, what's arguably dishonest about this image on the right? Not to say that it's set out to be so, but what's more truthful about this that we don't see in that? Or what do we see here that we would never see here? Part of it, I think, has to do with what I discovered when I made that little visit to Metten. And you look a little closer at this, you know, I just assumed this is all carved marble, and that's pretty expensive stuff. It's like, wow, I always thought this was a wealthy monastery. Oh my goodness. Oh no, 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 no. Oh my, and neither was Eichstätt. And lest we think that our founding monasteries were monasteries with plenty that they could spare, guess again. These monasteries, which only numbered in the tens, you know, sending five members each to this place out in this godforsaken, it wasn't even a state yet, this territory called Minnesota that no one had ever heard of, you know, never to come home again. These monasteries were not actually that wealthy. And when you look a little closer, sort of like the Wizard of Oz, and you go over and you notice, and then you notice some more, and you realize that in fact, most of it's just painted. That's not expensive marble. My gosh, they weren't one of the wealthier monasteries at Metten. They just had some very talented painters, like we did. Somebody got busy with a brush and did some trompe l'oeil, we call that, to make it look like marble or granite or something. Well, the granite, sure, but who can carve that in 1874? Marble, you'd have to go all the way out to Vermont to find some marble. This is crazy. There's no way they could have carved stone. Oh no, that's cast plaster. Oh my gosh, this whole thing is, you could argue, a stage set. This is, we're looking at things that are trying to be more expensive as materials than they actually are. And understandably so, because when you build a church and you want to create something important, something that shows the beauty of what can happen with your architecture, and you can't afford the most expensive materials, you invent. You get creative. And I take a hat off to all of those monks who manage to do such things. But a modern architect would say, yes, that's marvelous, but it's not truthful. It's not honest. That's really not what it is. Can the materials be what they are without being masked? Can you build with things and let them show you what they are, a modern architect would ask. That's one kind of arguably dishonesty here. Another has to do with the actual architectural style itself. I think most of you might know that this is Romanesque, right? Does everybody know when Romanesque dates to? So we're looking at a church built 800 years before our own, with not an unsimilar style even for our towers. Dates back that far. So if we're going to look at just a little trace of architecture styles, and we come up to 1950, and the Bauhaus is before this, a modern architect would say, really? You want me to design in that style? Can we design in a style that's of our own age? Is that not more honest to design in your style, where you live, with your materials, with your techniques? I see so much, so many similarities between even Maria Locke and our own. And a quick lesson, since I've got the image up here, about building and floor plans. So we're all familiar with the cruciform floor plan. Most, even our own Great Hall, former Abbey Church, is done in this cruciform style with two transepts and a crossing and a nave. Very quickly, in Romanesque architecture, which, by the way, gets its name from the Romans, so really, the Romanesque style is 2,000 plus years old, because the Romans are ones who figured out how to do a barrel vault, huh? And the only way to do that and transfer the weight of your roof is to build a really thick, solid wall that you support at the base so that the wall doesn't collapse outward like that. We don't see a lot of this because very often it's below ground, but there has to be quite a lot of it to keep it from sliding out. It's a lot of weight to put down on the walls. Of course, it's in the Gothic period that somebody got smart and figured out a new way to transfer the weight from here rather than straight down into the first wall to build a second wall removed from it. Has to be thicker because now you've got weight really pushing at it at an angle. But that thick wall can be, there can be air here. And with air and less weight, this wall can be thin. Thin walls means you can open them up. It's during this time we have the flying buttresses and especially the flourishing of stained glass. Windows that can be the width of the wall can go all the way up to the top. We have this spilling of light into Gothic spaces that you could never have gotten in a Romanesque church because the walls had to be so thick. Nonetheless, that's a pretty old style, a modern architect would say, and it doesn't let its materials be who they are. So perhaps one way of defining what Baldwin might have meant with this honest use of materials is by using materials and construction methods that show what they are and how they were put together, and a style somehow appropriate to our time and place. Because, by the way, the last sentence of his letter says, in our position, it would, we think, be deplorable to build anything less, particularly since our age and our country have thus far produced so little truly significant religious architecture. Quick backstory to the Bauhaus school. Note the date. So just after World War I, a group of artists and architects and craftsmen put their heads together and they said, let's rethink the whole way that we have been training architects. Rather than learning from the top down or only designing in the abstract, Can we bring back what was really a Middle Ages practice of uniting all the crafts together so that there is no hierarchy? There's no architect sitting at the top of a heap of other people who build with wood and use metal and stained glass and textiles and typography and so on and so forth. Can we unite all of those? And can our architects begin at the bottom and work their way up? They named it the Bauhaus, or in English, several versions are the house for building or the building house, whatever, not the Institute for Architectural Studies. Very humble name for a very ambitious program that wanted to unite all of the design elements that go into a space. This was the schematic of their curriculum, trying to coordinate everything. You'd begin at the outer part of the circle and work your way in, and you get a sense of the timeline, at least 3.5+ years before you're ever designing a building, where you learn the materials, study nature, tools. Then you spend time in the glass studio, in the clay studio, in the stone studio, in the wood studio, and so on and so forth. By the way, Marcel Breuer is so good with his use of wood, he's appointed eventually the head of the furniture design studio. He knew wood inside and out. There's really nothing in the Abbey Church that is warping, splitting, or cracking unintentionally in the entire building. He knew what oak would do and designed with it accordingly. Some sample designs. They did everything, by the way. They were like a liberal arts residential program. They lived there, they played together, they worked together. They were a residential program for learning how to be architects. And how you learned was by learning to build and design everything that would one day go into your building. Rather than the shell of the building itself, you would design everything from the inside out. And that's the whole genre, the whole milieu, the whole mindset that Breuer comes out of. In his furniture design class, a sample question would be, tell me what is the essence of a chair? Is there such a thing as chairness? Needs a back, a seat for one, two would be a bench, no back would be a stool. Stable elevation, you gotta get stable elevation somehow so it doesn't, you know, leave you on the floor. But to get that stable elevation, does it need four legs? Well, this is a sculpture by James Crook. I wouldn't sit on it. Can it have only two? Can we do away with a couple legs, Breuer says. Breuer's one of the first to take advantage of hollow steel tubes for building. These Thonet chairs in the library, most of them are still all the originals. Classic, a solution to this problem. Can we achieve a design with less that is both aesthetically appealing and yet functional? He does the Vasily chair, nesting table. They just go on, and different versions of designs, even with bending plywood. By the way, the Vasily chair ends up in the Museum of Modern Art. You can, by the way, get one of the Barcelona chairs by Mies van der Rohe if you have $2,000 to spare. So here's the inside of the glass house by Philip Johnson. In modern design, everything inside would be of a piece. Everything would be harmonious. Everything would go together. So if he didn't, in fact, design the furniture, it would go with the building somehow. It would feel like all of it was a, you wouldn't put a Louis XIV armoire in here and then a shaker chair over here. And then, you know, you would in postmodern design, but you don't do this in modern design where everything was meant to be unified. And by the way, that whole aesthetic is what informs Vincent James' design for the Guesthouse. Textures, simple materials that show you what they are. Planes, floor-to-ceiling glass, views to the outside, very modernist, definitely through and through. So an ad for Marcel Breuer's furniture. He made a living with that furniture through the 20s and into the 30s. And here it sits, and I love this, if you just ignore the Andy Warhol for a moment. Everything else, so these are paintings by artists asking the very same thing about painting. So what is the essence of a painting at the end of the day? Does it have to tell a story? Does it have to reference anything outside of itself? Or really, at the end of the day, isn't a painting pigment on a surface, period? Can we pull out the essence of painting? They're asking, even as we have an example of furniture by someone asking the very same question. So here he is, at the age of my students, here he is near completion of the Abbey Church, presenting to Baldwin and some of the monks over in Wimmer Hall. They chose him, by the way, for several reasons, but not least of which, because Baldwin says he listened well. They had considered Frank Lloyd Wright, though he was nearing the end of his life and trying to finish that Guggenheim Museum just when they were contemplating this whole project. Thank goodness we didn't end up with someone like Frank Lloyd Wright, who, as arrogant as the day is long at this time, would tell you what you wanted rather than listen to you and try to adapt the design to be really functional. Marcel Breuer listened, apparently, and he would go back again and again, and Hillary, you can probably attest to that more than anyone else in the room. This ability to adapt the design so that the function, we'd still arrive there, that would still be tantamount, even as we're trying a new design. They asked him for a whole grand master plan, by the way, and he gave it to us. Here it is in model form, so imagine everything in the style of this, or Tommy Hall, lots of white, lots of plainer design. Fortunately, we didn't have money to do that, so we didn't tear down the quad. It's the idea that people were doing away with old architecture at that time period, thinking, got to pave the way for the future. We don't need to hang on to any of that. That's amazing to me now, I think to all of us in this room now. We have a much more profound love for history, and things don't have to be so uniform and so harmonious that we do away with this heritage that we've inherited. But he gave a lot of thought to it. Zones of usage, where people would travel, where they'd walk, how the thing as a whole would work. Gave us the library with the two trees of knowledge and wisdom that hold up the ceiling in another innovative way. The runner at the four-way stop, one of the few sculptures he ever did in his life. And of course, the facade. Here it is in an earlier version. Pretty clunky, pretty, well, yeah. I don't know what else to say. And really not elegant yet. The legs that were holding up this very strange tower that no one had ever seen before. That honeycomb pattern seems to be the best solution. It's extraordinary. It is so symbolic, and the repetition of it works so well, and it's so strong as a shape. It forms the grid for that window on the north side. We've all been in it. We've all been in it at least for the first time, passing under this enormous arch as we approach. And we more often than not would have gone through those two doors as opposed to the center door that I'll show you in a moment. They had to start with a monastery wing, which I show you here, front and back views. And I also show you the Farnsworth House to show you the similarity there with other modern architects. That horizontal line, the verticals, the glass, the color even, which would contrast beautifully with whatever is outside. This view to the outside. I love living in the Breuer Wing. I know not all the monks would choose to live there, but I love it. And the amount of light that comes in through that one window alone, it just throughout the day, it's extraordinary. Everybody knows, I think, that the entire church had to be first built in wood before it could be poured in concrete. So that there was at one time an entire structure out of wood first that is no longer there is extraordinary to me. What remains is what we see even here. All the forms into which the concrete was poured and the texture that left behind. It's the floor plan that I challenge my students on. This is not like a typical floor plan, certainly not of the Great Hall. It also faces north, as opposed to the traditional east-west axis. I often ask my students, why do you think that is? And they scratch their heads and come up with all sorts of possibilities. And until they realize that the freeway hadn't been there yet, or was on its way, and was due to cut off our main entrance to the campus, which meant we would now be coming from the north as opposed to the east. Breuer said, you don't want to be looking at the side of your church when you come onto campus. It should turn and face you as you come onto campus so that it speaks to you directly. But it's the shape of the thing that's so extraordinary. And I can't help but overlay this object on it. I do it. A photograph I would have taken from the roof of the Abbey Church looking at one of our bells, but it fits it perfectly, and I didn't reshape the bell. The clapper is actually exactly where the baptismal font is, which to my mind, and he does mention a bell. It occurs in the Walker Art Center bulletin that comes out at this time for the dedication of the Abbey Church. He does mention a bell, but he doesn't talk about this, and I'd be curious if he ever did, if he ever even spoke about that as inspiration. But what's interesting to me about a bell is you've got all that wonderful bronze that makes no noise without that little ball of metal, the little tiny clapper, just like we have no church without baptism. Baptism, and for us, what is also underneath it, the reliquary, all those who've gone before us, we have nothing without that sacrament. In particular, oak, 12 feet high from our woods. And its shape that is always startling. It is not the arrow that points to the sky, which is what most steeples do. Effectively, they are like an arrow, a finger pointing somewhere. You are meant to look where it's pointing. And of course, when a bell is ringing, churches were meant to remind us that there's God and it's time to go pray. Ours doesn't do that. Ours, instead of pointing to the heavens, actually parallels the earth in an extraordinary way. Breuer did some traveling to Greece, by the way, when he was younger, and admits that he was inspired by the idea of a freestanding tower that would have a bell visible and a cross on top. But how to do that in a new way with better building techniques here in America was the question. And ultimately, we end up with this structure where the bells are visible, no longer hidden in the two towers, visible on top of this enormous banner that you could be carrying in a procession, something that presents a shield or a bolt of cloth or something that is not an arrow, and instead, that line draws our attention instead to the earth, which, for me anyway, is a profoundly different orientation, a reminder that God is everywhere, especially in the community, in those around us. We needn't look further than the people next to us for this presence of God. Rather than up some 30,000 feet up in the heavens. God is everywhere. And I love the fact, from an architectural point of view, a design point of view, that horizontal line subliminally does that for me. Get up to it, of course, it's a very dynamic shape. Not at all static. But it's the materials themselves and how they've been used that really resonates with the honesty. Clay brick, poured concrete, granite. He says you're sitting on one of the world's largest deposits of granite, Cold Spring. We've got to use it somehow in this design. Oak, metal, glass. The thing we see the least, probably the rebar, the stuff inside all that concrete. But boy, we do see the wood. Even though it's no longer there, it's staring us in the face. It's imprint. To me, that's profound as well, just from from all sorts of perspectives, but the idea that we have a building that had been embraced by a material which is no longer there, and yet we see its ghost, we see its spirit, we see its evidence. I love that aspect in this place. Very judicious use of precious metal. And repetition of form on an interesting set of scales. That's the lid to the baptismal font. These are the legs to the cantilevered balcony and underneath the bell banner itself. Going in, notice we don't go through something profound and grand like you might at St. Peter's in Rome. We go through very plain oak doors that are only 7 feet tall, very humble, going into a very intimate, quietly lit space with light at the center spilling down over lots of greenery, water that's constantly moving. You can't have a symbol or have water be a symbol of life if it's stagnant and it's got scum on it and it never moves. Then you do move through, and most people miss it, but you do move through copper doors after baptism. As you come into the what was meant to be this heavenly hall of fellowship with other believers, you pass through another set of materials, but it's very understated and most people walk right on by it. I can't get over the repetition of form in here. For me as a sculptor, these are four of the most amazing shapes anywhere. That balcony gets overshadowed by everything else that people talk about. It's an extraordinary thing. It doesn't even touch the walls anywhere in the church. It's completely freestanding, that enormous structure. And how it's done with these beautiful open spaces that only when you go up that ramp to the balcony do you get to enjoy. It's the window that was, I think, the stickiest point for Breuer. He and Josef Albers, the famous stained glass artist at the Bauhaus school, wanted a whole different color palette. They wanted this, effectively. After many, many versions, they wanted a window, and he writes it over and over in the letters that even I came across online, with orange and yellow and red, the warm end of the color spectrum. And Bruno Bach's design doesn't do what these two windows over the altar do. That. Instead, they do this. And I just imagine, I'm exaggerating here, that's too much. But it would be a whole different color if the architect had gotten a window design he thought would really work for that space. By the way, Ham Smith sends this telegram to him when the committee voted in favor of the Bruno Bach window. Church votes Bach window. Should we take last-ditch action? Ham Smith, I'm dying to know what the last-ditch action was. But still, no matter what, there's so many extraordinary things that happen in this church. He does things where he takes these vertical lines that support the ceiling and ends up in empty space. He does just the opposite of what they probably should have done, and that is go right into the ground from there. There are all these nooks and crannies that you can't see. There are hidden spaces in that Abbey church that are not visible. You can't see the whole space from any one place. You can't stand in the center and perceive the entire space. Not possible. That mysteriousness, I love being in that space. The texture for me, this feels like cloth when it's lit up at night. It feels like rough silk, where the concrete that oozed through some of the boards creates this beautiful horizontal texture running up the wall in every place. It's a gorgeous space lit up at night. It just really is. I should love to show this because students don't realize that, oh my gosh, not only is it slanting, but they get smaller and then wider. And this whole space up in the catwalk, you start by crouching down as you come up behind the organ screen, climbing up that narrow spiral stair by the pipes. And you have to crouch. And then by the time you get to the front of the church, it's cavernous. It's an enormous space under each of those V's. It's wonderful symbolism in the Bruno Bach window, though, just amazing. From the water of life, the River Jordan, and the seasons. But at the end of the day, this is a radical transformation from a very German space, I would argue. Beautiful in its own way. Wonderful Romanesque church. Gorgeous carving. My gosh, if I could carve like that. But not as simple, not of the essence, the way this space is, at least for me. That wonderful canvas that is red. I'll show you in a moment some of the possibilities, thanks to Ellen Reed. We have just a couple sculptures in there. I throw this in. This is that wonderful Madonna and Child from the 12th century. The reliquaries under stairs, and that's up in the attic. I'll show you this very briefly. Thanks to some Photoshop, we've imagined what would have happened if Breuer had found an artist who could create what was supposed to be a mosaic. So all those tiny little bronze rectangles, each one was supposed to hold a tile, a colored tile, not fill it entirely either so that sound could come around it. That was supposed to be a mosaic of Christ in glory, surrounded by the apostles, saints, angels, you name it, just a wonderfully busy image of Christ in glory, so that through baptism and the font, we die with Christ. Through the Eucharist, we are part of the passion of Christ, and then we move into a visual representation of heaven. Didn't happen, but what if it did? What if it was a Chagall? Or a more traditional Byzantine image? They're wonderful. But if you sit with them long enough, you might find, as I do and others have decided, that what actually happens to the church is it becomes an elaborate frame for this. And if that image were there, it would be what we looked at every day, as opposed to something maybe a little less figurative. So just imagine a Rothko. Or a Diebenkorn, genius, Alan, to use a Diebenkorn. It starts to play on the architecture of the space. Who knows? But something that stays in the simplified realm is probably much more useful in that space, much more harmonious in that space, as opposed to something that would be figurative. I throw this in as well because there was a wonderful show of Marcel Breuer's entire career. It was out at the Rhode Island School of Design a couple summers ago. And somebody went to great lengths to build several models of his buildings, and they did it at the Abbey Church in particular. And you know, we weren't supposed to take photos, but I figured, well, this is amazing. Even, I just imagine if we had clear or rippled glass and we could see the bells swing. I can't imagine another place on earth where that transformation has happened. The church is only a couple years older than I am. I don't know what that says. But from childhood on, and I only got to put words to this more recently, I realized that I thought monks belonged to the future. Their church didn't look like our church in St. Cloud. And if we were going to a high holy feast, like Christmas or Easter, we didn't go to our own church. We came here, St. John's. And in this extraordinary space that I would, if we came out to swim at the beach on a hot summer's day, invariably somebody had to use the bathroom. And I looked forward to coming up and sneaking into the church and going down into the basement where it was cool, and then coming up and sitting up in the balcony for 15 minutes just because it was so quiet and such an extraordinary space. And I'm only 10 years old, and I don't know what I'm doing there. But believe me, I never, ever contemplated becoming a monk until Daniel Durkin, you can blame him, invited me to come spend just a couple days when I was a college student. But I remember thinking that this place doesn't look like anything from the past. This is the future. This is at least the present. And it's pretty bold. It's pretty striking. And that phenomenon, that sense from an early age has stuck with me. I don't know. Who knows? We have a challenge in front of us, praying in a very large space as a smaller community than when the church was designed. We're not 350 anymore. We're 150 right now. And we could very likely get significantly smaller than that. How do you pray in that enormous space when you're not such a large monastic community? I don't know the answer, but I think we can find a solution to it because it is such an extraordinary space to be in. I thank you for your time, and I'd be happy to answer any questions, but thank you for coming. Thank you.
Thank you, David Paul. The three mics are there for questions, comments, observations.
Gosh, it's already 10 after 8. I apologize to all you Downton Abbey fans. Sorry about that. Yes, John.
I'll ask.
Is it about Bruno Bach?
No, it's about Satan. John, you gotta switch the mic up. So I've had this question in my mind the last few years. A few times we've been at evening prayer and a group of people will come in the side door and will march underneath the balcony, chatting, talking, discussing. Joyous people, good people, coming probably from the guest house, spiritually alive people. But it's like we're praying and they don't even get it. So I'm kind of saying that I think all this stuff you talk about in terms of exquisite modernist design is really kind of excessive in its presumption. It's like presumes. I sense that people come into the church and don't even have a clue that it's a place of prayer. It doesn't even faze them. You know, they just walk right through, they talk, it's like Grand Central Station. They're going to get a bus on the other side, you know. And I've been in other places, other modernist churches, most recently the cathedral in Los Angeles, which is definitely a modernist church. But you go into that space, and it's unmistakable. This is a place of prayer. This is a place. You can go look at some of the nice art if you want. But this is really kind of a place to pray. And when I was there, there were all kinds of people around milling about, even into the sanctuary. But it was all very prayerful. And there were people in the pews praying. And I don't see that in our Abbey Church. I don't see it evoking immediate. Maybe it's a subtle thing, and most people have to be there 30 years in the monastery to kind of get it. I don't know. In some ways, I'm in agreement with you. I think there were some stylistic innovations and ingenuity that were happening. I think the play of light thing that you described, to me, if anything could evoke a kind of a natural sense of prayer, that should be it. But I guess I just don't see people getting it. Most people don't get it. And I guess I'm just wondering, you know, what is it? What's all the style? What's all the building? What's all the materials? But really, what do people get a sense of when they come into the place? You know, it doesn't seem like it's prayer is the first thing. It might be kind of wow or oh, this is interesting. Or I don't feel like they're not asking. When they come to do tours, I don't say, well, where's the Blessed Sacrament? We want to go to the Blessed Sacrament Chapel. You know, nobody asks that question. Sometimes they ask, why isn't it on the altar, you know? But maybe you could address that. Why you walk into a building and, you know, you go into artistic exaltation about beauty and space. But what about walking into a church and saying, you know, I guess maybe I need to kneel down and pray?
You're asking two really good questions. One of them is, and I can't answer it, what do people think when they come in for the first time? I wish we could poll people's first reactions, because I think we'd see some spectrum there. But it would include what you just described, that some people don't experience it immediately as a prayer for space. Secondly, do people get modernism? And I think the answer is no, by and large. How do I say that? I can only give you a before and after reaction from my own students. So until I explain this and then take them on a walking tour, both of the Great Hall and then of the Abbey Church and up into the catwalk and down into the lower chapels, and they have a different experience after that of that very same space than they did before. So I know that people come with less understanding of modernism than they are capable of. And I know that when people learn something more, they don't necessarily fall in love with it, but they have a different understanding of it, and at least some appreciation of it that they didn't have before. We are living in a culture that is definitely not modernist. Though modernism has never died, you can pick up Dwell magazine or Metropolitan magazine, all sorts of design magazines, and still see houses and office buildings and not so much churches, but buildings being designed in what people could call a true modernist style. Materials that show you what they are, that reveal how they put together, that are done in a slightly minimalist way, less ornamentation, more about texture and color and form and so on and so forth. So modernism hasn't died, but it's now had to share the stage with postmodernism and everything else that has now come into being. And I think people don't know what to do with a space that is almost brutally empty. No artwork visible until you poke around in the corners or go behind the abbot's throne or, you know, go downstairs where most of our artwork actually is. I don't think they know how to place that space in any of their experience because it seems so pared down from what most churches would have. So I would agree that most people don't come with a full understanding of that movement that flourished in the middle of the 20th century but never really went away. But what people actually think, I don't know, because I know there's some students who come in on their own at night and sit in the quiet. I know that there are people who students come to Mass there and like being able to move around the space. They start out in the nave, and then they all gather up in the choir stalls and around the altar for the Eucharist. They like moving in that space, and at night, which is when they have their student Mass, it's dramatically lit. So it's a different space than during the day. I don't know what people's perceptions are across the board. I don't doubt that there are people who don't think of it as a sacred space. Victoria Young at St. Thomas would even say some of her colleagues say that about the church. It's not a sacred space. It doesn't feel like one. It doesn't has the sense of one. And these are professionals who would argue that. So it's definitely a bold structure. And it hasn't made converts of everyone by any stretch. Microphone.
I think that the iconic treatment of the organ screen was essential to Breuer's notion of making the space a sacred space. He didn't have a picture in mind, but he thought something could be done there that would clearly identify this space as a holy place. Oddly enough, he didn't think of the north window at all as symbolic and didn't really want it, as it turned out. But I often think that we, sitting up in the choir stall, have the advantage of seeing that window, which is quite obviously religious. But everybody sitting out in the body of the church has the back to that window, and instead are looking at a blank screen. So I do think that some kind of treatment of that organ screen that is clearly iconic, I think figurative probably wouldn't work very well. But in the long run, a century or two, I think it would be nice to finish off the church with something. I might mention, too, that a couple of years ago, we had an organ concert here one afternoon, a beautiful organ. And some people came who had never been here before. And afterwards, they said, when are you going to finish the church?
Your students are lucky people, so are we. When the Abbey Church was going up, there was a cathedral going up in a neighboring diocese that I'll not name. And a European artist was visiting that city and looked at it and said, look at all these lovely materials being piled so haphazardly. So I wonder what was going on, not just that the abbot, Abbot Baldwin, could write that letter in 1953, but what was happening in the community that would allow this to happen.
Hillary or anyone else from that generation, can you speak to that? Please, yes. That's a great question, William. Thank you.
Kaz Marsick.
Yes. Here.
I don't mean that to be cynical. That church, in many, many, many respects, the church as finished is a tribute and almost a monument to Frank Kaz Marsick, who worked very, very closely with Breuer.
And, exactly and so. I arrived on the campus, entered the community in 1953. I was a novice, professed in 54. But I want to go back to, what is this? We employed an architect in Japan, Takagaki. He visited one of the key architects. Chinese, is it P?
I am Pei.
And asked I am Pei what he considered the most significant architect 20th century. Pei said, without doubt, Breuer. How would you see describe this architecture? Timeless. It's 55 years I've been here. I can't consider any of this old. It's as fresh as the day that I arrived here. Timeless. What we do, the flexibility is enormous. We didn't get trapped into one only thing. Yes, if you wanted to say, we have 36 private chapels, we never thought that it was going to go. There's oodles of thousands of ways of continuing to develop. I'm glad that you mentioned we didn't tear down. I was ordained to the priesthood in the old, in 1959. I think mine is the last name of priest ordained there. Yeah. But that space still is beautiful and has not been abandoned and utilized. Anyway, I say no more, we're just timeless. Takagaki and Chinese, yeah. But I was reading The Ghost of Frank. Anyone who didn't know Frank should have their stories endless. And don't hide them. Time for another book on Frank, to be frank.
Mm.
I was actually thinking of the pyramid in the Louvre that IMP put in, and there's a wonderful movie about that construction where what it did in Paris was take art which had been protected and very safe and turned that same space into a thoroughfare. So many people walk under the Louvre and they don't know they're going by great art. They don't think about it, but it created movement in a space that had been shut off to people before. And so about the, what do people know about your Abbey Church who aren't members of your community? I wanted to let you know about an exercise I've done with a class I teach called Reading Biblical Women, where we talk about strategies for interpreting the Bible. And at some point, we sing a Latin hymn in the classroom, which is very people are not very inspired. And then we go into a stairwell in the quad, and the acoustics are much better there, so we sing a little better. Then we go into the Great Hall, and we sing, and it's better still, but there's the peep of the phone at the information desk. And then we come into the Abbey Church, and it's very obviously a sacred space. And we're very quiet and sing this hymn. And students have sometimes said in their surveys that it's that exercise that helped them see what we were trying to do in interpreting the Bible. And I'm wondering if the sound or the empty space that sound contributes to in the church is part of what makes it obviously sacred. So is sound part of a visual in a way in that Abbey Church?
God, I think they definitely go hand in hand. Yes. Oop, sorry. Yep. Bob.
I think that part of the answer to what was asked earlier, he said they came in from the guest house, or they come in from the Great Hall. What you see when you come in through either of those entrances is a tunnel under the balcony leading to the other side. If you get to the middle on your way across and happen to glance to the side, oh, there's an altar there. But if you, as I was fortunate enough to do, my first time up here, I parked out in front. There was a place to park out there, and I came up the steps into the baptistry, and that, coming into something here. Go through the copper doors, and what do you see? You see that. That's what you see. And that is awe-inspiring. But that's not what you see when you come in through the sides. But it is if you come in through the front.
Yeah. You spoke about how in the modern art period, I don't like microphones, so I'm like trying to get away from it. But it's getting at this essence of a thing. And so I'm really intrigued by trying to get out why Breuer was chosen to think about what is the essence of what this space is talking about. The essence, we keep talking about the materials and how the materials speak, but what does it speak of the Benedictine life? How has it shaped the Benedictine life, especially even just coming from you personally? I'm just curious about what that essence is, and can you speak to that a little bit more?
I can try off the top of my head, unless anyone else would like to try. Yeah, oh. Did I mention Hillary's book? Yeah, sure. Yeah. Yeah.
But this person, it's so interesting to think of using, always in architecture, you're using materials. You're thinking about the materials you're using.
Yes.
Functionality of prayer, even, and how the space is used for prayer. I'm trying to
It's a really good question. I can't speak to the intention on that in that regard on Breuer's part, but I can speak about my own experience of it. And I would say a couple things that come to mind. I remember remarking, even as a novice, to our novice master, Timothy Kelly, how there were times in that first year in the monastery where I just liked closing my eyes at prayer and not even reciting along with the monks, because of the way the acoustics in that space seemed to flow over me and behind me and under me. And granted, there were a few more of us in those days, but even so, I was struck tonight, because I was thinking about this very kind of thing tonight, that even with a smaller number of people, the acoustics, put it this way, the acoustics are very kind to everyone's voice in that space. They make the choirs sound more harmonious than they would be if you went down the line and listened to each monk and wondered whether or not he was in tune with the other or not. The acoustics are amazing for creating a sense of oral community, in my mind. They help us blend with one another in a way that is wonderful when it comes to singing. Now, for the opposite reason, being in the basement helps us blend better when we speak. But we don't sound very good when we sing downstairs, just my opinion. But the acoustic does something amazing in both of those places, and I think the upstairs one does this phenomenal thing with not a lot of voices to create a sense of community. But it doesn't feel like a grand space to me when we're sitting up in the choir stalls, and I also thought about this recently. I think I've spent 95% or more of my life in the upper choir stalls as opposed to down in the nave or somewhere else in that church. And when you're in the upper choir stalls, the extraordinary thing about the design of the church being more like a bell and closer, the walls closer together at the sanctuary end and the choir end, is that it creates actually visually a smaller room on this side of the altar than it does on the other side of the altar. And all that oak, all those pews, the balcony, it all sort of disappears, especially at night in the wintertime and in the morning in the wintertime, which seems to be half the year. It's this sea of darkness that's a wonderful complement to this altar. And I don't go in there and feel like, gee, I feel like a pea in a boxcar, you know, this tiny little thing in an enormous space, because it actually has the opposite effect on this end of the church, where we gather so often throughout the day. Even so, it's not the church that we spend so much time in. It's actually the rest of the monastery. And it's a smaller scale when you get out of the Abbey Church and into the corridors and then ultimately into rooms. They're very modest in size. And there's something not so grand or overwhelming about that, though we'd all like to change the acoustics.
Joan and Jack.
Yeah, Joan. Sorry, that's not a great answer to a very good question. But.
Brother John made me feel guilty. For 52 years, I've cut through the Abbey Church when it was raining, snowing. And it made me think, you know, do I think of that as a prayer space? It's an Abbey Church. It's a church that was built to allow a monastic community to pray together. And it is true, if you're sitting in the pews underneath the balcony, you have the sense you are a spectator. So that space back there, to sit up in the balcony, you have a different space, you have a different experience. But under the balcony, that is very much, I'm not sure I know the right analogy.
It's like looking at a stage.
That's
just correct. Guessing.
And you have the same process of walking through. It's no excuse for not praying when I walk through there, but it is the experience that you have. But I think the idea, it is a monastic worship space. And I know when graduation day, when we lay people are allowed to sit up there, I share that marvelous experience of looking up at that light coming in through that window. And it's a really strong impression.
Thanks, Joel.
Jack.
One more, yeah. Dad.
Yeah. Well, you speak about a place of prayer and so on, and what I keep thinking about is the nature of prayer, what it is you think you want to accomplish, how you want to do that, who are you talking to, etc. So to speak about the environment of prayer, I think we need to say something about prayer also.
Yes, indeed.
We're running up against, yep. I want to be respectful yep. of people's time here, so I'm just very grateful for your being here this evening, and great observations and questions and contributions here. David Paul, thank you.
Oh, you're welcome. Yes, thank you.